The United States uses 80 to 85 billion cubic feet of natural gas per day. That's about 30,000 billion cubic feet per year. We use it for cooking, heating, electricity generation, and manufacturing many modern products such as fertilizers and pharmaceuticals. And on a national scale, it can be used as a power leverage. So come along and join me and a guest subject matter expert speaker today as we overview on why and how we process, liquefy, store, and transport natural gas. So liquefied natural gas, or LNG, is a natural gas predominantly consisting of methane, and it's not to be confused with LPG or NGL. Liquefied petroleum gas is a condensate composed primarily of propane with smaller quantities of butane, and natural gas liquid is a general term for the liquid heavy hydrocarbons that are separated from the natural gas. So by liquefying the natural gas, we can reduce the volume by at least 600 times. This number comes from dividing the specific volume of natural gas at ambient temperatures by the specific volume when it is at negative 260 degrees Fahrenheit for the same atmospheric pressure. Methane also has the highest heating value and hydrogen to carbon ratio compared to other alkanes, which contributes to its combustion efficiency. So this is an overview of a typical LNG chain of processes. So the natural gas from the oil well is separated from the crude oils, purified, and dehydrated through upstream fuel processing before it gets delivered to the end users. We first pretreat the gas by removing impurities such as hydrogen sulfide. We then pre-chill the natural gas to remove heavy hydrocarbons, which are sent to a fractionation facility for separation to ethane, LPG, and gasoline. Finally, we chill the natural gas to liquid form through a series of heat exchangers that are known as cold boxes. This P&ID shows the processes from the feed gas through pretreatment, liquefaction, and then storage and export. As you can see here, the heart of all these processes is the liquefaction section, which follows the general refrigeration cycle and facilitated by a Joule Thomson medium such as a control valve, expander, or turbine. These refrigerant systems can either be pure, mixed, pre-cooled mixed, or cascade design in order to cut the power of the compressor. In the following example, our SME Mr. Trinh is going to walk through an example of a cascade refrigeration system.
We have multi-stage cold box. Not only that, each compression system, methane, ethylene, and propane is a multi-stage compressor, at least three stages, in order to improve the efficiency on each refrigeration system. But we also employ heat integration in the system in such a way that you take the liquid propane, you flush down to JT control valve to cool down the ethylene gas to condense it. So once ethylene becomes the liquid, in turn, you can even use ethylene liquid to condense the methane, and you can even use part of the liquid propane to condense or at least cool down the methane vapor liquid. At this point, methane is still vapor liquid until it cools down on the last part of the ethylene to become liquid. So now with the heat integration and multi-stage compression system and multi-stage cold box, you can imagine how efficient the system is to cool down the natural gas from 90, even 100 degree up in the summer, all the way down to minus 260, ready to store into the LNG storage tank. Now, the reason this system is very popular out there because the thermodynamic efficiency is almost 93% at least, and compared to the rest of other technology with little less than 93% or some even less than 90%. So that's why ConocoPhillips multi-stage cascade is so popular.
Now, all of these cryogenic processing happens in LNG trains, which be classified as two basic types. There are large units on the waterways with carrier ships providing a continuous supply of LNG, and smaller peak shaving plants that store and regasify the LNG when fuel demands increase in the winter months, hence the term peak shaving. They ensure an uninterrupted supply to end users during a short period of peak demand, operating only on selected portions of the year and are located near the point of usage, which makes them very capital efficient to operate. Now, one big safety difference to note between natural gas and its liquefied counterpart is that while the natural gas will rise when it leaks to the atmosphere, LNG's vapors are initially heavier than the air and then it spreads along the ground when it leaks. This leaves them open to a potential ignition source and flashback resulting in a great explosion. This is also another reason why the LNG terminals are located along the waterways. It's both for the convenience of exporting and for safety reasons.
Now, some of these are located completely offshore like the Adriatic terminal, while some are docked inland. Process safety and risk assessment along with economics are evaluated to determine these exact locations. Now, the US production of natural gas has been significantly high since the shale gas discovery, so there have been several proposals over the past years to convert the regasification terminals, which were originally built for importing natural gas, into exporting terminals. It's an expensive proposition since it costs money to liquefy the natural gas, but the United States is currently set to potentially become the world's biggest exporter of LNG. So when it comes to the storage of natural gas, protection and insulation are key. Thus, a full containment tank is used with both outer and inner tanks being capable of independently storing the LNG. Material of construction accounts for cryogenic temperatures that are as low as negative 450 degrees Fahrenheit. Full containment LNG tanks designs were based on 9% nickel steel inner tank and a pre-stressed concrete outer wall with a reinforced concrete roof and base slab. So the nickel steel inner tank has normal operating conditions. The carbon steel outer tank, which is 3 to 6 feet distant from the inner tank, supports the outer roof and is also prepared to contain the refrigerated liquid and control the venting of the vapor in case of a leakage. Both inner and outer tanks have insulation between them to help maintain initial cryogenic temperatures. There is also a bottom heating system in order to avoid frost heave. So the question is, what are the safety concerns of storage and how do we mitigate them?
Rollover is a potentially dangerous phenomenon that can happen when you have a stratification in the tank because of different layers of LNG, because of different density. Now, the less dense at the bottom is going to rise up, and the more dense layer on the top is going to sink down in the rollover fashion. So it can happen during the unloading of LNG at the import terminal and in the tank containing LNG with the different composition and density. So it's a very dangerous phenomenon that can lead to overpressure and gas release from the tank unless you have a very good pressure relief system to handle the overpressure and protect the system against such a scenario. Now, the second scenario that's very dangerous is the ball of gas of LNG because the tank's receiving heat during the shipping, loading, and unloading, and that can generate natural gas vapor due to heat leakage into the tank through insulation. So the gas compression facility needs to be properly and adequately designed to safely recover and handle ball of gas, and that you can either recompress that natural gas back to the system through the recondenser by exchanging heat with LNG, or you can send out to the downstream. So this picture down here, you can see the dotted line represent the ball of gas from the two tank and go to the compressor section, and that compress into the revaporizer system and sent to the downstream facility. Now, in order to revaporize the LNG, we have two methods that commonly used out there. The first of them we call the submerged combustion vaporizer, or SCV, which the LNG passes through tubes immersed in the water bath and being heated by submerged burner. And the other type is the open rack vaporizer, in which the LNG can pass through the tube with water, and that you can use either seawater or river water that run down on the outside of vaporizer tube as the film layers. So the picture you see here, basically typical open rack vaporizer, you can see the seawater coming down to tube on the outside, and LNG inside the tube rise up in countercurrent, and then it's go to the downstream facility. And the picture down here, you can see that's a typical size of the open rack vaporizer. Now, the other type, basically the submerged combustion vaporizer, it's just the furnace that's immersed in the bath of water, heat the water, and the heated water, which in turn to vaporize the LNG against go through the tube, and the natural gas evaporize and send out to the downstream facility. The picture you see is the typical fire furnace at the terminal that to regasify the LNG from the tank before it's sent to the downstream facility.
LNG ships are specifically designed to handle LNG as opposed to other products like oil. They're typically 250 to 350 meters in length, and they're well equipped with leak detection technology to ensure a safe and secure uncompromised transport. As I mentioned before, technical challenges include insulation, managing boil-off gas for liquefaction, and economy of scale. This schematic visualizes what happens when LNG is unloaded. Once the LNG is returned at an import and regasification terminal, they are pumped to the required pressure and then vaporized to a high-pressure gas sales pipeline where they go to various homes and commercial businesses in the form of CNG or compressed natural gas, which is stored up to a few thousand PSI.
Because LNG is much denser than compressed natural gas, higher amounts of gas are able to be transported for the same amount of volumetric flow. Thus, LNG pipelines are costly because they account for the maintenance of low pressure and assurance of preventing regasification through mechanical insulation, while on the other hand, compressed natural gas requires much less capital-intensive equipment. So in this video, we cover what natural gas is, as well as why and how we liquefy, store, and transport natural gas in a cost-effective and responsible manner. As EG2 CEO Toby Rice states, the best way to combat climate change is a dramatic increase in liquefied natural gas, which would supersede coal in electricity generation. With the trend in decreasing global emissions, natural gas will continue to be the bridge towards a sustainable future. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you learned something from this video. Make sure to follow and subscribe for more content like these. Feel free to reach out with any questions and comments and feedback that y'all might have. And as always, never stop learning.